Chapter 16. General Sherman's Achievements at Vicksburg. After the Battle of Corinth, which was fought on the 4th of October, 1862, the army under General Grant fell back to the position which it formerly occupied, and remained in comparative inactivity until the beginning of November. It was stationed from Memphis to Bridgeport, Tennessee, along the Memphis and Charleston Railroad. Its strong points were Memphis, Grand Junction, and Corinth. The army was arranged in four divisions. General Sherman, with the 1st Division, was at Memphis. General Hurlbut, with the 2nd, was at Jackson. General C.S. Hamilton, with the 3rd, was at Corinth. And General T.A. Davies, with the 4th, was at Columbus. Grant's headquarters were at Jackson, Tennessee, a point in the west where the Central Mississippi Railroad unites with the Mobile and Ohio. That general had not abandoned the plan which was inaugurated at Henry and Donelson. His whole soul was bent on the capture of Vicksburg. A variety of circumstances, however, had necessitated delay. The removal of Halleck to Washington had devolved upon him the entire care of the Department of the Tennessee, a department which included, in addition to Cairo, Forts Henry and Donelson, the whole of northern Mississippi, and those portions of Tennessee and Kentucky west of the Tennessee River. This, however, was not the only or even the most important reason. A weakened army. The army which had fought and won at Shiloh, at Corinth, and at Iuka had been greatly weakened, a large proportion of its strength having been sent to Kentucky to resist the invasion of Bragg. It was necessary, therefore, for Grant, while perfecting his plans and rearranging his troops, to wait for reinforcements. As soon as the reinforcements arrived, he was ready to move. The national gunboats had swept the Mississippi from Cairo to Memphis, and between those two points every Confederate stronghold had been deserted or destroyed. Farragut, with a portion of his fleet, had pushed his way up to Vicksburg after the capture of New Orleans. He was accompanied by General F. Williams with an infantry force of 4 regiments. While Farragut bombarded the city, Williams was cutting a canal with the view of diverting the waters of the Mississippi from their proper channel, thus leaving Vicksburg high and dry on all sides. Fruitless siege. The siege lasted some 70 days. It was all to no purpose. Farragut, who failed to make any serious impression on the Confederate works, began to fear for his own safety. The canal also proved a complete failure. The fleet and the land force both found it necessary to retire, and Vicksburg remained to obstruct the navigation of the great river. On the 4th of November, Grant began to move. He transferred his headquarters from Jackson to Louisiana Grange, some few miles to the west of Grand Junction. He soon discovered that the Confederates, under General John C. Pemberton, a Pennsylvanian, who had superseded Van Dorn, were in considerable strength immediately in his front. Pemberton, in fact, had taken a strong position behind two lines of defenses, the outer being the Yallabusha and the inner being the Tallahatchie, two streams which after their junction form the Yazoo River. Both of these streams cross the Mississippi Central Railroad between Grand Junction and Grenada. The banks of the Tallahatchie were strongly fortified. Grant's first intention was to offer Pemberton battle, defeat him, and force his way to Vicksburg. Sherman and Grant laying plans. On the 8th, he sent out McPherson with 10,000 infantry and 1,500 cavalry, with instructions to drive from Lamar a body of Confederates who were holding the railroad. McPherson accomplished his task in the most effectual manner, the Confederates having been driven back as far as Holly Springs. The time had now come to make a determined effort to open the Mississippi. About the 17th of November, Grant summoned Sherman to meet him at Columbus, and at the interview which there took place the views of the two generals were freely exchanged, Grant explaining to Sherman his plan and giving him his orders. It was Sherman's suggestion that a portion of Curtis's army, which was stationed at Helena, should be brought over to Delta with a view to cooperate with Grant in his general movement towards Vicksburg. These troops, which, in the absence of General Curtis, who was at St. Paul, were under the temporary command of General Frederick Steele, were promptly at the place appointed on the eastern bank of the Mississippi. They numbered some 7,000 men and were under the joint command of Generals A.P. Hovey and C.C. Washburn. Ordered to scour the country to the south and east in the rear of the Confederate army, to destroy the railroads and bridges so as to cut off supplies, and generally to prepare the way for Grant's advance, they accomplished their task in the most effectual manner and then returned to the Mississippi. Confederates fall back. Pemberton, on discovering that the railroads were badly damaged and that the rolling stock was destroyed, Grant, meanwhile pressing on his front, deemed it prudent to fall back on Grenada. On the 1st of December, Grant was at Holly Springs. On the 5th, he was at Oxford, where he established his headquarters. It now became a serious question with General Grant how far he was wise in allowing himself to be tempted to advance into the enemy's country. The state of Mississippi was but sparsely peopled, and he had no means of knowing whether its resources were equal to the wants of a large army, possibly cut off from its base of supplies. Had he known what he knew afterward, the caution would have been unnecessary, and he would doubtless have continued his onward march. On the 5th of December, Sherman, on his way to join Grant and bringing with him from Memphis some 16,000 men, arrived at College Hill, about 10 miles from Oxford, whence he reported to his chief. On the 8th he received from Grant a letter requesting his immediate presence at Oxford, and enclosing a message from Halleck to Grant authorizing the latter to prosecute the new plan he had just submitted to him, to move his troops as thought best, to retain till further orders all Curtis's troops now in his department, to telegraph to General Allen in St. Louis for all the steamboats he might need, and to ask Porter to cooperate with his gunboats. Plan of Land and Naval Attack. On his arrival at Oxford, Sherman found Grant surrounded by his staff. The new plan was discussed and approved. It will be seen that Grant made up his mind that, for the safety of his men as well as for the final success of the expedition, it was necessary to take full advantage of the river communication with Vicksburg. It was agreed that a large force on transports should proceed down the Mississippi under convoy of Porter's gunboats, that on reaching the mouth of the Yazoo they should open up that waterline, and by a joint attack of the land and naval forces attempt to capture Vicksburg in the rear. Grant, meanwhile, was to press forward toward Jackson, which is only some 46 miles to the west of Vicksburg, offering Pemberton battle and following him up close in the event of his retreat, in the hope of finding Sherman on the Yazoo with supplies or in possession of Vicksburg. Happily, Grant had been left complete control of the whole movement, Halleck having offered no special advice and imposed no conditions. He could move at will, and he could place in prominent command the men of his own choice. Sherman's Command. Sherman, who commanded the right wing of Grant's army, was appointed to the command of the river expedition and received his instructions. Grant had the greater pleasure in appointing Sherman to this command that McClernand, who had great influence with the president, was known to be intriguing for an independent command on the Mississippi. Sherman was therefore ordered to take command of the forces at Memphis, and those also at Helena and Delta under General Steele, to descend the river by transports with the gunboat fleet, commanded by Admiral Porter as a convoy, and to attack Vicksburg by the 29th of November. McClernand was to take the forces at Cairo and to proceed to Vicksburg, so as to be in time to lend Sherman effective aid as soon as he made the attack. Grant himself, as we have said, was to move rapidly on the Confederates to the north and east of Vicksburg, to follow them if they should retreat toward the city, and to take part with Sherman, if necessary, in the reduction of the place. Ready for action. It was a well-conceived plan. Its success, however, depended on the prompt and faithful execution of all its parts. Grant knew that it was unsafe to trust for supplies solely to the enemy's country. He had therefore repaired the Central Mississippi Railroad as far as Oxford, where, for the present, he had established his headquarters, and Holly Springs, which was entrusted to the care of Colonel R.C. Murphy, was retained as a Grand Depot and hospital. Let us see how this plan was carried out. Grant had taken great care that no misfortune should befall him in his rear. He had left small but adequate garrisons at Columbus, at Humboldt, Trenton, Jackson, Bolivar, Corinth, Holly Springs, Coldwater, Davis's Mills, and Middlebury. He had taken particular care of Holly Springs, for he knew that the treasures at that place presented a powerful temptation to Van Dorn. On the night of the 19th, he warned Murphy of his danger, and informed him that he had sent 4,000 men to enable him to repel any attack which might be made upon him. Murphy, it would seem, paid little heed to the instructions given him. He made no extra preparations to resist the enemy, and was clearly unequal to the occasion. On the morning of the 20th, at daybreak, Van Dorn, executing a brilliant cavalry operation, rushed upon the place with tremendous fury. Murphy offered no resistance. The 2nd Illinois, however, refused to surrender and gallantly fought their way out with a loss of only 7 men. Murphy, with the rest of his men, accepted a parole. Van Dorn seized all the property, valued at over $1,500, taking with him what he could carry and destroying the remainder. He set fire to the buildings, not even sparing the hospital, which was filled with sick and wounded soldiers, and committed an act of inhuman barbarity. Cowardly and disgraceful conduct. This was the 2nd time that Murphy had been guilty of such conduct. He did the same thing at Iuka. General Grant was wild with rage. It was his opinion that with all the cotton, public stores, and substantial buildings about the depot, Murphy ought to have been able to keep the assailants at bay until relief arrived. It was only 4 hours after the catastrophe when the 4,000 men sent to his aid arrived on the spot. Grant was particularly incensed at Murphy for accepting a parole for himself and his men. A cartel had been agreed to by the rival commanders, and it had been stipulated that each party should take care of his own prisoners. If Murphy had refused parole for himself and men, Van Dorn would have been compelled to release them unconditionally or to have abandoned all further aggressive movements for the time being. In a severe order on the 9th of January, General Grant dismissed Murphy from the army, the order to take effect from December 20th, the date of his cowardly and disgraceful conduct. The disaster at Holly Springs was ruinous to Grant's plan. It robbed him of supplies which it was intended should sustain the army for several weeks. To replace them, it would be necessary to put in operation all the capacity and force of the Columbus Railroad, but this railroad had been destroyed, and weeks would be exhausted before it could be put in working order. Ignorant of the resources of the country, and not knowing whether, in the event of his pressing forward, he should find Sherman in the vicinity of Vicksburg, he deemed it his duty to fall back. He immediately recrossed the Tallahatchie. The Game of War. Having no other means of subsisting his army, he made requisitions on the inhabitants as he moved along. On the 23rd of December he was at Holly Springs, now a scene of wreck and ruin, and a few days later he re-entered LaGrange and Grand Junction, where he was once more in communication with Corinth and Memphis. Pemberton made no attempt to pursue. On the contrary, taking advantage of the retreat of his antagonist, he withdrew the greater portion of his forces from Grenada and concentrated toward Vicksburg. On the same day that Van Dorn made his raid on Holly Springs, an attack was made by a Confederate force on Davis's Mills, a little farther to the north. In the neighborhood of Jackson, Tennessee, a vital point in Grant's line of communications, an attack was made by a body of cavalry under Forrest on the 19th. The telegraph wires were cut, and the railroad was destroyed. Hopes blasted. On the following day, Forrest presented himself before Humboldt and Trenton. These and other stations along the railroad, such as Dyer's, Rutherford, and Kenton, fell an easy prey to the enemy. It seemed to be the purpose of the Confederates to destroy every railroad bridge from Columbus to Corinth, and thus to cut Grant off from all his communications and supplies. So far, they had carried out their purpose with determination and with not a little success. Never was campaign opened under apparently happier auspices. The rich bud of promise, however, was cruelly blasted. Grant's plan of the campaign had failed. Meanwhile, what of Sherman? On the 20th, the very day on which Van Dorn and Forrest struck the blow which compelled Grant to fall back and abandon his part of the joint undertaking, Sherman took his departure from Memphis. Taking with him over 20,000 troops and transports, he left as a guard to the city a strong force of infantry and cavalry, and the siege guns in position with a complement of gunners. On the following day, at Friar's Point, he was joined by Admiral Porter in his flagship Black Hawk, with the Marmora, Captain Getty, and the Conestoga, Captain Selfridge, which were to act as a convoy. The remainder of Porter's fleet was at the mouth of the Yazoo. On the same evening, the 21st, the troops at Helena embarked in transports and came to Friar's Point. Sherman's force was now at least 30,000 strong. All the arrangements were completed, and the joint expedition was moving down the river the following morning. A strange story. Sherman got away in time to secure for himself the glory or dishonor of the expedition. Had he lingered a day longer, he would have been superseded in his command by General McClernand. It is a strange story, and one which, for the sake of all parties concerned, it would be well if the world could forget. We will not enter into details. It has already been stated that General McClernand was a warm personal friend of President Lincoln, and that he was ambitious of an independent command on the Mississippi. It is not necessary to say that Sherman was a man according to Grant's own heart. Since that great day at Shiloh, their fates had been linked together, and they had been to each other like David and Jonathan. Sherman was also a great favorite with Halleck, the commander-in-chief at Washington. But for the personal wishes of Grant and Halleck, both of whom knew well that Sherman was the man for the position, McClernand would have been appointed by Lincoln in the first instance to the command of the river expedition. McClernand, however, was not to be put off, and Lincoln, who was always unwilling to disoblige a friend, was weak enough to yield to his entreaties. On the 18th of December, an order from the President reached Grant, directing him to divide all his forces into four army corps, to assign one corps to McClernand, and to place him at the head of the troops destined for the attack upon Vicksburg. Embarrassing situation. Grant could hardly fail to see in this order a blow aimed at himself. It was a most awkward circumstance, and reflected little credit on the wisdom and good sense of the President. Good and great as he was, Lincoln was not without his weaknesses. He was vain enough to imagine that he knew quite as much as his generals in the field, and he was disposed to deal with military officers as he was in the habit of dealing with politicians. It is not much to be wondered at if Grant was staggered by this order and if he was slow to put it in execution. It was not difficult for him to find an excuse. He was in the midst of his preparations for an onward march. The reconstruction of his army, according to the instructions received, occupied him the whole of the 19th. The disaster at Holly Springs, compelling a backward movement, occurred on the 20th, and the raids of Forrest on the same day deprived him of the use of the telegraph. Every inch a soldier. As it was, Sherman had proceeded down the river before any counter-instructions reached Memphis. If Sherman had any reason to fear a counter-order, his haste to get ready and his prompt departure but revealed the soldierly spirit and true character of the man. As the result proved, it was well for Sherman, well for General Grant, and well for the nation at large that Lincoln's order did not take effect before the 20th of December. On Christmas Day, the expedition under Sherman and Porter had reached Milliken's Bend, when Sherman detached Burbridge's brigade of A.J. Smith's division to break up the railroad leading from Vicksburg to Shreveport, Louisiana. Leaving A.J. Smith's division to await the return, the remaining divisions proceeded on the 26th to the mouth of the Yazoo, and up that river to Johnson's plantation, some 13 miles, and there disembarked. Insurmountable obstacles. The disembarkation was conducted without any opposition. Steele's division landed farthest up the river, above what is called Chickasaw Bayou. Morgan's division, a little lower down, at the house of Johnson, which had been burned by the gunboats on a former occasion, Morgan L. Smith's division, below that of Morgan, and A.J. Smith's, which arrived the next night, below that of M.L. Smith. The ground on which Sherman now found himself presented obstacles of which formerly he had but a very imperfect conception. Vicksburg is built on a range of bluffs known as the Walnut Hills. These hills, which take their rise a little below the city, extend for the most part in a northeasterly direction, terminating in Haynes Bluff, a distance of some 13 or 14 miles. The configuration of these hills has been compared to the ridge at Inkerman, to which it is said they bear in some particulars a striking resemblance. Their average height is about 200 feet. Natural defenses. Where the Mississippi touches their base at Vicksburg, and for some miles both above and below, they are precipitous. Along their entire length, indeed, from Vicksburg to Haynes Bluff, their face is very abrupt and cut up by numerous valleys and ravines. The only approach to the city by land from up the river is by climbing their almost perpendicular front. The ground beyond is high, broken, and somewhat rolling, gradually descending to the Big Black River. The Yazoo, which skirts the ridge at Haynes Bluff, about 9 miles above Vicksburg by the road along the foot of the bluffs, flows in a southwestern direction, and before discharging its waters into the Mississippi crosses an old arm of the river, which now forms a semicircular lake. The Yazoo evidently, in times gone by, clung to the foot of the hills, and traces of its former whereabouts are to be seen in the numerous bayous and channels by which the intervening ground is cut up. One of these bayous puts off from the Yazoo about 1/3 of the distance below Haynes Bluff, running at right angles with the river until it approaches the bluffs, when it turns and follows their base until it empties itself into the Mississippi. It is called Chickasaw Bayou. Frowning Batteries. Between the bayou and the hills there was an irregular strip of land on which the trees had been felled to form an abatis. It was dotted also with rifle pits. Rifle trenches abounded, too, along the front of the bluffs, and the heights above were crowned with batteries. About a mile to the northeast of the bayou, and parallel with it, there is a deep slough which makes a sharp turn as it approaches the bluffs and enters Chickasaw Bayou at the point where the latter is checked in its course and turns to flow along the base of the hills. There was thus a fortified line some 12 or 13 miles in length, formed of abatis and rifle pits, with an impassable ditch in front and terminating in the powerful fixed batteries at Haynes Bluff on the one hand, and in the heavy batteries and field works above Vicksburg on the other. The land lying between the Yazoo and the Chickasaw was not only low and swampy, it was, except in one or two places where there were plantations, densely wooded. The distance from Johnson's landing to the Chickasaw was about 6 miles. Such was the ground over which Sherman proposed to march his men. Such were the obstacles to be overcome before he could enter Vicksburg. To the national commander, however, and to his officers, these obstacles were, as yet, but imperfectly known. Sherman's Valiant Army. General Sherman's army was organized in 4 divisions. The 1st Division, comprising 3 brigades, was under Brigadier General George W. Morgan. 2nd Division, 3 brigades, under Brigadier General Morgan L. Smith. 3rd Division, 3 brigades, under Brigadier General A.J. Smith. 4th Division, 4 brigades, under Brigadier General Frederick Steele. The brigade commanders of the 4th Division were Generals Frank P. Blair, John M. Thayer, C.E. Hovey, and Colonel Hassenderbel. According to Sherman's plan of attack, General Steele was to hold the extreme left, General Morgan the left center, General M.L. Smith the right center, and General A.J. Smith the extreme right. As the latter general had not yet arrived from Milliken's Bend, where we left him waiting for Burbridge, General Frank P. Blair, with his brigade, was detached from Steele's division and placed on Morgan's right. Clever strategy. The object of this arrangement was to distract the enemy's attention, leading him to expect an attack at a number of different points. Instructions, however, had been given to each of the commanders to converge toward the point of attack at or near Barfield's plantation. There it had been discovered the bayou could be crossed at two points, at a sandbar and at a narrow levee. On the 27th, the army began to move. General Steele, who had been ordered to take position on the further side of the slough above his bayou, experienced great difficulty in landing his troops. So soft and slushy was the ground and so dense was the brushwood that he found it necessary to construct roads for moving his wagons and artillery. When night came, he had only advanced some 2 miles from the shore. During the greater portion of the next day, he pushed forward his command, but he was compelled to report to Sherman that he found it physically impossible to reach the bluffs from his position, and that to persist in the attempt would inevitably lead to the ruin of his troops and the loss of his field equipage. Pressing forward. He was therefore ordered to leave some of his troops behind him as a show of force, to hasten to the west side of the Chickasaw Bayou, and to take a position on Morgan's left. On the 27th, Blair moved slowly toward the bluffs, his desire being to give Steele time to come into position on the left. He succeeded in silencing one of the enemy's batteries at the point where he expected Steele would be able to join him and held his ground. On the 28th, the various divisions pressed forward, and the National troops were in full possession on the Yazoo side of the bayou, with one bridge thrown across and with two bridges partially constructed. During the course of the day, while reconnoitering, General M. L. Smith was severely wounded in the hip and compelled to retire to his steamboat. Selecting positions. His command devolved on General Stuart, but Sherman, feeling convinced that A.J. Smith could accomplish nothing on the extreme right, because of the heavy fire of the forts immediately in his front, ordered him to leave Burbridge in position at that point and to come up with a portion of his forces to the point selected for crossing the bayou, and entrusted him with the execution of the task. Such was the state of things on the night of the 28th. General Morgan was in position on the west, or rather southwest, side of the Chickasaw. General Blair was a little to his right, near the angle of the bayou. General M. L. Smith's division, under General Stuart, was on the right center. General A. J. Smith's, which was farther to the right, had taken position near the place where the bayou was to be crossed, and General Steele was moving up on the left to act as a reserve to Morgan. The Grand Attack. On the morning of the 29th, all things were in readiness for the attack. It was Sherman's object, as he himself has told us, to make a lodgment on the foothills and bluffs abreast of his position, while diversions were being made by the Navy at Haynes Bluff and by the 1st Division directly towards Vicksburg. We have already mentioned that there were two crossings, one in front of Morgan and another a little farther to the southwest in front of M. L. Smith. An attempt was made by A. J. Smith to throw a light flying bridge over the bayou, more to the right. On the extreme left, a little above the angle of the Chickasaw, near the house of Mrs. Lake, Blair's men had succeeded in constructing a bridge, but not without great difficulty and with very considerable loss. Storm of Fire. Sherman expected great things from General Morgan, who, as we have seen, commanded the 1st Division and was to lead the attack in person. Sherman pointed out to him the place where he could pass the bayou, and received for answer, "General, in 10 minutes after you give the signal, I'll be on those hills." His position was one of considerable difficulty. The crossing was narrow, and immediately opposite, at the base of the hills, there was a Confederate battery, supported by infantry posted on the spurs of the hills in the rear. This was the real point of attack. But to distract the attention of the enemy, Sherman's instructions were that the initial movements should be made at the flanks. It was about noon before the signal was given for a general forward movement across the bayou and toward the enemy's position. A heavy artillery fire was opened all along the National line. It recalled the memory of Iuka and Corinth. The Confederate batteries made a prompt reply, and were soon followed by the infantry, which opened a perfect tempest of lead on the advance ranks of Morgan and A.J. Smith. In the midst of this fierce storm of cannon shot and musketry, De Courcy's brigade of Morgan's division succeeded in crossing the bayou, but the fire was so terrific that they fled for cover behind the bank and could not be moved forward. General Blair, meanwhile, had crossed the bayou by the bridge above the angle, and had reached the slough, the bottom of which was quicksand and the banks of which were covered with felled trees, these obstacles greatly impeding his advance. Desperate assault. With great difficulty, and not until his ranks were thrown into some disorder, was the crossing of the slough accomplished. This done, it was necessary before reaching the enemy's works to traverse a sloping plateau raked by a direct and enfilading fire from heavy artillery and swept by a storm of bullets from the rifle pits. Nothing daunted, Blair and his brave brigade, his own and his officers' horses having been left behind, some of them floundering in the mire and vainly seeking a foothold in the quicksand, went bounding across the plateau. Rushing upon the rifle pits, they captured the first line, and then the second, and made a desperate effort to gain the crest of the hill on which the batteries were planted. Colonel Thayer of Steele's division had followed Blair with his brigade over the same bridge. Entering the abattis at the same point, he turned somewhat to the right, and emerged upon the plateau almost simultaneously with Blair and about 200 yards to his right. Unfortunately, however, Thayer found that he was followed by only one regiment. His second regiment, after his movement, had commenced having been ordered to the support of Morgan, and the other two regiments having followed this one by mistake. It was a sad blunder, and one which contributed not a little to the disaster of the day. Thayer discovered the mistake before he had fairly brought his troops into action, but he was too brave a man to halt or hesitate in the circumstances. On he pushed to the right of Blair and rendered effective aid in the capture of the second line of rifle pits. The odds were fearfully against him. An unequal struggle. Leaving his regiment to hold the position it had won, he hurried back, with Blair's consent, to obtain reinforcements. It was a trying interval. The moments seemed hours. It was a struggle, as has well been said, between 3,000 in the open ground below and 10,000 behind entrenchments above. The hillsides bristled with bayonets and blazed with the fire of musketry, while from the angry mouths of huge cannon destruction was poured forth upon the shattered and rapidly thinning ranks of the assailants. Blair, impatient for the return of Thayer, rushed back himself to persuade the advance of more troops. It was all in vain. Both Thayer and himself failed in obtaining reinforcements. No help reached them. No diversion was made in their favor. They had no choice but to order a retreat. Blair and Thayer fell back with a loss of at least 1/3 of their men, and De Courcy, who had been attacked on the flank by the 17th and 26th Louisiana, lost 4 flags, 332 men made prisoners, and about 500 small arms. Heroic bravery. The attack was a complete failure. Somehow, the signal for attack was imperfectly understood. Either that, or it was not heard at all on the right. Two divisions had remained immovable, while a handful of men were being crushed in a desperate attempt on the left. A.J. Smith had done nothing. Stuart had managed to push one regiment across, the 6th Missouri, which had orders to undermine the bluff. The position of those men was one which severely tried their faith and patience. They were exposed to the vertical fire of the Confederate sharpshooters who occupied the ridge, and a battalion of the 13th Regulars, who were stationed opposite and who attempted to protect them from the Confederate fire, proved equally dangerous with the enemy above. "Shoot higher!" shouted the Nationals below the bluff. "Shoot lower!" cried the Confederates. After dark, this regiment was brought back over the bayou. The remainder of Steele's division did not get up in time to be of any assistance to Blair. Morgan failed to make good his promise. He did not even obey his orders. Disobedience and disaster. General Sherman was particularly severe on Morgan. To him and to his conduct he attributed the failure of the attack. "This attack failed," he has since told us in his memoirs, "and I have always felt that it was due to the failure of General G.W. Morgan to obey his orders or to fulfill his promises made in person. Had he used with skill and boldness one of his brigades, In addition to that of Blair, he could have made a lodgment on the bluff, which would have opened the door for our whole force to follow. Sherman was naturally mortified at the lame and impotent conclusion of a movement which he had fondly and confidently believed would result in a great and decisive victory. Baffled and even humiliated, he was not dismayed. He resolved to make another attack, and arrangements were made to push forward General Hovey to the position from which Blair had been driven. Morgan's division, with the brigades of Blair and Thayer, to follow and support. For some reason it was not done, and next morning it was found to be impossible, because of the increased strength of the Confederates at the menaced point. Firing was continued on both sides during Tuesday, and on Wednesday, the 31st, a flag of truce was sent in, and the dead were buried, and the wounded cared for. The sad burial. An eyewitness has given us a sad picture of the battlefield on that day of burial. All across the plain, scattered among the abatis and hid away in little entanglements of bogs or tufts of bushes, they lay, Confederates and Federals, side by side, showing how the battle had rolled and surged with the alternate charges of either party. But the saddest sight of all was that of the unfortunate wounded, who had lain through all these weary hours since the battle, uncared for, many of them, because the nature of their wounds prevented them from moving. Others were held fast by a little knot of corpses which chance had thrown upon them, and still others, perhaps not wounded at all at first, but being caught beneath the horses they rode as they fell, were pinned to the earth. The frantic appeals for water, for food, or other succor of such of these miserable victims of war as could speak at all were most heart-rending. The great commander's new resolve. Sherman was still dissatisfied and resolved to make another attack. After consulting with Admiral Porter, it was agreed that a combined naval and land assault should be made on Haines Bluff, the key to the Confederate position. Porter was to proceed up the Yazoo with his gunboats and open fire on the bluffs, while General Steele was to land his division out of range of the enemy's guns, then to push forward and take the position by storm. The attack was to be made during the dark hours. By 2 o'clock on the morning of Thursday, the 1st of January, the necessary arrangements were completed. A heavy fog, however, had enveloped the entire district, and so dense was it that Porter found it impossible to steer the boats. It was utterly out of the question to make any further efforts. On the night of the 29th December, there had been a tremendous rainstorm. All the low ground was flooded, and the men, who had been bivouacked for 5 successive days in those wretched swamps without fire, were suffering cruelly from damp and cold. On the 2nd of January, Sherman placed his troops on board the transports, and the fleet sailed down to the mouth of the Yazoo. Sherman's disappointment. Thus ended, somewhat ingloriously, the second campaign against Vicksburg. Sherman had accomplished nothing. He had, however, made great sacrifices, his loss in killed and wounded and prisoners amounting to nearly 2,000 men. Such was the Battle of Chickasaw Bayou, or, as it is sometimes but less correctly named, the Battle of Haines Bluff. It was a sad disappointment to the people of the North, and Sherman, from whom great things were expected, came in for a large share of abuse. Several of the correspondents on the spot, ignorant of some of the causes of the failure, and not knowing as yet the fate which had befallen Grant, were unnecessarily severe in their condemnation of Sherman. That he meant well, that he was resolved to win, and that his plan was well conceived, there can be no doubt, but somehow the execution was not equal to the conception. A fatal mistake. There was some mistake in giving the signal, and the real assault was made by only 3,000 men. If Blair had been sustained in his attack, as he ought to have been sustained, the National Army would most undoubtedly have effected a lodgment on the heights, and, although hard fighting must have followed with doubtful success, it is not at all impossible that Sherman might have reaped all the glory due to the capture of Vicksburg. He proved his generalship in the face of impossibilities. Blair will be remembered as the hero of Chickasaw Bayou. He fought like a warrior of old, face to face and hand to hand with the foe. After Blair, praise is due to Thayer, who gallantly sustained his companion in arms. The battleground, no doubt, had much to do with the defeat. To anyone of less daring than Sherman, familiar with the district and well informed as to the strength of the enemy's position, the undertaking might have seemed impractical from the outset, and it is questionable whether even he, had he possessed a fuller knowledge of the difficulties which beset him, would have imperiled his fame and risked the lives of his soldiers in a task so apparently hopeless. Success impossible. It was doubtless a mistake not to have more thoroughly and officially reconnoitered the ground before choosing it as a field of action. After all, however, it was an experiment which might have been successful, and it was not the only unsuccessful experiment which had been made before Vicksburg was captured. As it was, everything might have been well if Grant had been able to carry out his part of the plan. The retreat of the latter from Oxford, leaving, as it did, Pemberton free to concentrate his troops for the defense of Vicksburg, largely diminished Sherman's chances of success. The Confederates were jubilant after this first victory. It was undoubtedly a great triumph. General Pemberton, not without reason, felt proud that he had baffled Grant in person, compelling him to retreat, and that he had, temporarily at least, saved Vicksburg by the defeat of the greatest of Grant's lieutenants. These rejoicings in the South were not unmixed with sorrow. The more thoughtful of the Confederates knew that defeat only intensified the purpose of the war. We left the transports and the fleet on their way down the Yazoo. At the mouth of that river, General McClernand was waiting with orders from the War Department to take command of the entire expedition. That general, it will be remembered, was appointed to this command by the direct influence of President Lincoln. It was a severe blow to Sherman, who felt it keenly. It was some consolation, however, to him to know that the appointment, which had been made weeks ahead and which had no connection with the recent disaster, was not intended as a disgrace. With a modesty which became a man of his high spirit, he accepted the situation and explained to McClernand what had been done, accepting the entire responsibility of the failure. Referring to the trains of cars which could be heard coming in to Vicksburg almost every hour, and the fresh troops seen on the bluffs, he gave it as his opinion that Pemberton's army must have been pressed back and that Grant must be at hand. He then learned, for the first time, what had befallen Grant, McClernand stating that Grant was not coming at all, that the depot at Holly Springs had been captured by Van Dorn, that Grant had fallen back from Coffeeville and Oxford to Holly Springs and LaGrange, and that when he passed down Quimby's division of Grant's army was actually at Memphis for stores. By common consent, all further attempts against Vicksburg for the present were abandoned, and the entire force left the Yazoo and returned to Milliken's Bend on the Mississippi. On the 4th of January, McClernand issued his General Order No. 1, assuming command of what was to be called the Army of the Mississippi, and following the plan which had been agreed upon at Washington, and which had been adopted in the armies of the East, dividing his forces into two corps. The first was to be commanded by General Morgan, and was to be composed of his own and A.J. Smith's divisions, and the second, to consist of Steele's and Stuart's divisions, was to be commanded by General Sherman. The rest of the Army of the Tennessee was similarly divided, General Hurlbut being placed in command of one corps, and General McPherson in command of the other. The supreme command of these four corps was retained by General Grant. On the same day, General Sherman issued the following order. Dated January 4, 1863, Headquarters Right Wing Army of Tennessee, Steamer Forest Queen, Milliken's Bend. Pursuant to the terms of General Order No. 1, made this day by General McClernand, the title of our army ceases to exist and constitutes in the future the Army of the Mississippi, composed of two army corps, one to be commanded by General G.W. Morgan and the other by myself. In relinquishing the command of the Army of the Tennessee and restricting my authority to my own corps, I desire to express to all commanders, to soldiers and officers recently operating before Vicksburg, my hearty thanks for the zeal, alacrity, and courage manifested by them on all occasions. We failed in accomplishing one great purpose of our movement, the capture of Vicksburg, but we were part of a whole. Ours was but part of a combined movement in which others were to assist. We were on time. Unforeseen contingencies must have delayed the others. We have destroyed the Shreveport Road. We have attacked the defenses of Vicksburg and pushed the attack as far as prudence would justify, and, having found it too strong for our single column, we have drawn off in good order and good spirits, ready for any new move. A new commander is now here to lead you. He is chosen by the President of the United States, who is charged by the Constitution to maintain and defend it, and he has the undoubted right to select his own agents. I know that all good officers and soldiers will give him the same hearty support and cheerful obedience they have hitherto given me. There are honors enough in reserve for all, and work enough, too. Let each do his appropriate part, and our nation must, in the end, emerge from the dire conflict purified and ennobled by the fires which now test its strength and purity. All officers of the General Staff not attached to my person will hereafter report in person and by letter to Major General McClernand, commanding the Army of the Mississippi, on board the steamer Tigress at our rendezvous at Haines Landing and at Montgomery Point, by order of Major General W. T. Sherman, J. H. Hammond, Assistant Adjutant General. Before the arrival of McClernand, Sherman and Porter had agreed upon a plan for the reduction of Fort Hindman, or, as it was called, Arkansas Post. About 40 or 45 miles from the mouth of the Arkansas, there is a piece of elevated ground, the first high land on the banks of the river after leaving the Mississippi. At this point, the river makes a sharp bend. Here the French had a trading post and a settlement as far back as 1685. Sherman bent on conquest. The Confederates had taken advantage of the place to erect some fortifications, the principal work being named Fort Hindman after the famous guerrilla chief. Behind these works they kept several steamboats, which were wont to sweep down the river and intercept supplies. Sherman had experienced some inconveniences from the existence of this stronghold. He had left Memphis in such haste that he had not been able to take with him a sufficient supply of ammunition for his guns. The Blue Wing, a small steamer carrying a mail, towing some coal barges, and having with her the necessary supplies, had been sent after him. This boat had been pounced upon at the mouth of the Arkansas, captured, and with all her supplies taken up to Fort Hindman. It was Sherman's conviction, from the moment he learned of the fate of the Blue Wing, that before any operation could be successfully conducted against Vicksburg by way of the Mississippi, it would be necessary to reduce Fort Hindman and make an end of the Arkansas pirates. The plan approved. Sherman communicated his purpose to McClernand and asked permission to go up to the Arkansas and clear out the post. McClernand, who had not as yet, so far as appearances indicated, formed any plan of his own, went with Sherman on board the Black Hawk to consult with Porter. Porter, who had the highest esteem for Sherman, not only approved of the enterprise, but expressed a desire to go up the river himself in place of trusting the expedition to any of his subordinates. It was Sherman's expectation that he would be sent with his own corps alone on this business, but McClernand concluded to go himself and to take with him his whole force. The troops, which had not yet disembarked from the transports, were ordered to remain on board. Sherman's corps was in two divisions. The first, which consisted of three brigades, commanded respectively by Blair, Hovey, and Thayer, was under Brigadier General Frederick Steele. The second, which consisted of two brigades, commanded by Colonels G. A. Smith and T. Kilby Smith, was under Brigadier General Stuart. The transports with the troops on board, convoyed by the gunboats, of which there were three ironclads, proceeded up the Mississippi. Expedition against Fort Hindman. The force under McClernand amounted to some 26,000 or 27,000 men, comprising 40 regiments of infantry, 10 batteries with several guns of heavy caliber, and about 1,500 horse. On the 8th of January, the expedition was at the mouth of the White River. This river, which is one of the principal streams in Arkansas, rises a few miles east of Fayetteville, flows northeast into Missouri, then returns into Arkansas and, pursuing a southeasterly course, enters the Mississippi about 15 miles above the mouth of the Arkansas River. It is navigable by steamboats for about 350 miles. About 15 miles from its mouth, there is a channel or cutoff through which it discharges a portion of its waters into the Arkansas. If, as sometimes happens, the Arkansas should be higher than the White River, the state of things is reversed, and the waters of the Arkansas seek the Mississippi through the channel of the White River. The cutoff at this season of the year is always well filled and easily navigable. A formidable stronghold. On the morning of the 9th, the expedition, having ascended the White River, had reached the mouth of the cutoff. There was no delay in making the passage through to the Arkansas, a distance of about 8 miles. Steaming up the Arkansas, the boats reached Natrobe's farm, about 4 miles below Fort Hindman, shortly after 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Here they halted, and during the night the artillery and wagons were got on shore, the troops disembarking in the morning. Arkansas Post is on the north side or left bank of the Arkansas, at a point where the river makes a sharp elbow by flowing north, then east, then again abruptly to the south. The principal work, as we have said, was Fort Hindman. Its guns commanded the river as it stretched to the east and after it bent toward the south. This fort was a regular square bastioned work, 100 yards each exterior side, with a deep ditch about 15 feet wide and a parapet 18 feet high. It was armed with 12 guns, two of which were 8-inch and one 9-inch. Hold the fort or die. The garrison, which numbered only 5,000 men, was under the command of General T.J. Churchill, who was under the direction of General T.H. Holmes, then commanding at Little Rock. Churchill had received instructions to hold on until help should arrive or all were dead. This order showed the spirit of the enemy. The disparity of forces was great. It was 26,000 or 27,000 against 5,000. The strong position held by the Confederates, however, did much to compensate for inferiority of numbers. The fort itself was strong, and its approaches were of the most difficult description. Fronting on the river, it was protected on the west by a bayou, on the east by a swamp which did not quite reach the edge of the water. Between the fort and the swamp there was a ravine which stretched down to the river, and the front of this ravine was well fortified. The position had thus to be approached through the elevated ground which lay between the bayou and the swamp. The encampments of the Confederates were established in front of the fort in the center of the plateau dotted with clumps of trees. There was an outer line of entrenchments which stretched across the entire ground. Vigorous bombardment. On the 10th, the army was kept busy endeavoring to get a position in rear of the fort, Sherman on the right and Morgan on the left. Some mistakes were made in consequence of a want of knowledge of the ground. In the afternoon, and while the land forces were still seeking position, Porter was making good use of his flotilla. As he moved up the river, he shelled the rifle pits along the levee and drove the Confederates inside the fort. When about 400 yards from Fort Hindman, he brought into action his 3 ironclads, the Baron de Kalb, the Louisville, and the Cincinnati, and for half an hour the firing was kept up, the guns of the fort replying vigorously and with rapidity. On the morning of the 11th, McClernand, who had his quarters still on board the Tigress, had come up and taken a position in the woods to the rear. Early in the forenoon, he sent a message to Sherman, asking him why the attack was not begun. It had been understood beforehand that the opening of fire by the gunboats on the fort should be the signal for a general attack. The thunder of guns. Sherman therefore replied that all was ready, that he was within 500 or 600 yards of the enemy's works, that the next movement must be a direct assault along the whole line, and that he was waiting to hear from the gunboats. Half an hour or thereabout afterward was heard the clear, ringing sound of the Navy guns, the firing becoming louder and more rapid as they neared the fort. The National field pieces opened fire along the whole line. The thunder was terrific. The Confederates, most of whom were Texan volunteers, made a gallant resistance. A regiment of cavalry, abandoning their horses, fought on foot and rendered for a time effective service in resisting the advance of the Nationals. It was impossible for them to resist the fierce onset made by overwhelming numbers resolved to win or die. A storm of bullets. Sherman pressed forward on the right, Morgan on the left, each driving the Confederates back and gradually obtaining possession of the wooded ground in front of the newly erected parapet, but not without considerable loss. The Confederate firing was heavy, but the National soldiers took advantage of the clumps of trees and felled logs to shield themselves from the storm of bullets. Gradually, the edge of the woods was reached, the ground was clear, and there was nothing to protect them from the decimating fire of the enemy. Meanwhile, the gunboats were pouring a murderous fire upon the fort and sweeping the adjoining ground above and below with grape and shrapnel. Porter had brought into action not only the ironclads, but the ram Monarch, Commander Ellet, and even the frailer vessels, as he tells us, that amid the clouds of smoke they might do the best they could. The fort silenced. It was not long until the effects of this terrific firing began to be visible. All the adjoining ground was cleared of the foe. Nearly all the artillery horses in the fort were killed, and one by one the guns were being silenced. Shortly after 3 o'clock, the firing from the fort altogether ceased. The cannonading, however, was kept up by the gunboats. Porter, who had taken a regiment on board, was proceeding with the Black Hawk to attempt a landing and to take possession, when a white flag was raised in token of surrender. He immediately ordered the firing to cease. We left the troops in the clearing at the edge of the woods, fully exposed to the enemy's fire from the parapet outside the fort. This line had 3 sections of field guns, and they were handled, according to the testimony of Sherman himself, with great skill and energy. Javi was wounded. Thayer had his horse shot under him, and so thick and fast were the round shot falling about Sherman and his staff that they felt it necessary to scatter, Sherman himself dismounting. Morgan at this crisis unfortunately found himself in front of the ravine, beyond which it was impossible to pass. Prodigies of Valor. Sherman was now well engaged on the right, and Morgan, finding himself thus hindered, sent a few regiments to his aid. The burden of the fight, as at Chickasaw, had fallen on the brigades which now composed the division of General Steele. Blair and Thayer and Hovey performed prodigies of valor. On the right, the Confederate batteries had been all but silenced. Morgan's men on the left had done splendid work before they were brought to a standstill at the ravine. A.J. Smith's brigades had pressed the Confederates back step by step until they were within 200 yards of the fort. Burbridge expressly distinguished himself. But for the ravine, an attempt would have been made by the 120th Ohio to scale and carry by assault the eastern side of the fort. Almost at this moment, however, Sherman, as his attention was arrested by the flags of the gunboats visible above the parapet of Fort Hindman, saw a man jump on the nearer parapet at the point where entered the road which divided the peninsula. "Cease firing!" he ordered, and the words were passed along the line with amazing rapidity. The firing soon ceased. Sherman knew that something extraordinary was going on, and so gave his order. The White Flag. In a few seconds, the fort was invaded on every side by the National troops. Colonel Dayton was ordered forward to the place where he was hung out the large white flag, and as soon as his horse was seen on the parapet, Sherman advanced with his staff. It appeared afterward that the white flag was hung out without even the knowledge of Churchill. It made little difference. The battle had really been won on the land as well as on the river side of the fort. The surrender was subsequently made in due form, Colonel Dunnington, the commander of the fort, surrendering to Admiral Porter, and Colonel Churchill surrendering to the military authorities. The national loss in killed, wounded, and missing amounted to 970 men. On the Confederate side, there were only 60 killed and 80 wounded. 5,000 soldiers, with their officers, made prisoners, and all the property of the place, including some 17 guns, constituted the prize of victory. General Burbridge was singled out for the honor of planting the national standard on Fort Hindman. Such was the Battle of Arkansas Post. Sherman robbed of his honors. General Sherman was dissatisfied with the arrangements made by General McClernand immediately after the surrender. The post of honor, the occupation of Fort Hindman, was given to A.J. Smith of Morgan's division, Sherman being ordered to hold the lines outside and go on securing the prisoners and stores. McClernand's reason for doing so was that he did not wish to interfere with the actual state of facts, the status quo at the time of surrender. It was undeniable that it was Sherman's plan throughout, that his corps bore the burden of the fight, that after the surrender his troops were in possession of two of the three brigades which constituted the opposing force, and that he was in possession of all the ground outside the fort proper. McClernand was very proud of his success and manifested not a little vanity. His star, he said, was ever in the ascendant. In his memoirs, Sherman tells us that McClernand was extremely jealous of the Navy, and that in his report he ignored altogether the action of Porter's fleet. This was the less to be regretted that Porter told his own story in a very handsome and effective way. It is only simple truth to say that the battle was fought and won by the fleet before the land troops had any certainty of success. Petty rivalry. There was, in fact, a feeling of jealousy among the commanders, a feeling which was not wholly to disappear until the arrival of Grant, in whose presence and under the influence of whose more commanding genius, jealousy and selfishness gave place to a spirit of honorable rivalry and dutiful obedience. The day after the battle was devoted to burying the dead. The prisoners were all collected and sent to St. Louis. The victory at Arkansas Post opened the way for a successful expedition to Little Rock, the capital of the state of Arkansas. Sherman expressed a desire to be sent to this expedition. McClernand, however, did not deem it advisable. A combined expedition was therefore sent up the White River as far as St. Charles, Des Arc, and Duval's Bluff, under General Gorman and Lieutenant Commanding J.G. Walker. The expedition was completely successful. Meanwhile, the works at Fort Hindman were dismantled and blown up, and on the 13th, the troops were re-embarked and proceeded down the Arkansas to Napoleon. Their instructions were received from General Grant, who ordered McClernand to take the entire expedition down the river to Milliken's Bend and await his arrival. This place was reached on the 21st of January. The Second Assault. In itself, the movement against Arkansas Post was a small affair. It was so regarded by General Grant. It ought to have been successfully accomplished by one corps and by a portion of the fleet, instead of the combined strength of both, and that was Sherman's idea. But resulting as it did in victory, it served the double purpose of employing troops which would otherwise have been idle, and of cheering the hearts of a people who were somewhat despondent. In the Vicksburg campaign which succeeded, Sherman bore a prominent part with his command. In the expedition up Steele's Bayou to the Yazoo in March, the feint upon Hines Bluff, April 29th to May 1st, the movement to Grand Gulf, May 1st to the 6th, the capture of Jackson, May 14th, the occupation of Walnut Hills, and subsequent assaults upon the land defenses of Vicksburg, May 19th and 22nd, in each attempt the colors of the corps being planted on the enemy's work, and in the siege operations which resulted in the surrender of the city, July 4th, 1863, when Sherman, with a detached command, was at once ordered to pursue Johnston, who with a relieving force had been lying east of the Big Black, but retreating hastily on the news of the surrender. By the 10th, he was driven behind the entrenchments of Jackson. Siege operations were actively pressed, but on the night of the 16th, Johnston succeeded in escaping, thus proving himself to be the hero of retreats. Steele's division pursued to Brandon, and after destroying the railroads in all directions, Sherman fell back to the west of the Big Black, along which he lay when summoned, September the 22nd, to the relief of Rosecrans' beleaguered army at Chattanooga. Meanwhile, he had been appointed brigadier general in the regular army to date from July the 4th. By the 27th of September, the last of his command were embarked at Vicksburg, and by October 4th, Memphis was reached, whence he marched eastward, repairing the railroad as he proceeded, until the 27th, when orders reached him at Tuscumbia from General Grant, who had superseded Rosecrans, to abandon all work and hasten on to Chattanooga.